Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Habermas, A Very Short Introduction by Gordon Finlayson, narrated by Christine Williams.
Preface. Who is Jürgen Habermas? Jürgen Habermas is one of the most important and widely read social theorists in the post-Second World War era. His theoretical writings are influential in many different areas of the humanities and social sciences. Students of sociology, philosophy, politics, legal theory, cultural studies, English, German, and European studies will all undoubtedly come across his name at some time. There are several reasons why his work has such a wide influence. To begin with, Habermas is an interdisciplinary theorist. His range of reference is prodigious. He is the very opposite of what the sociologist Max Weber called a specialist without spirit, that is, the academic who never ventures beyond the narrow domain of his own expertise. Because his work transcends the disciplinary boundaries that most academics and students work within, most of his readers have only ever encountered one facet of his work. Furthermore, Habermas has been writing for nearly 50 years and has produced a huge amount of work. In addition to his profile as a social and political theorist, he is one of the foremost public intellectuals in Europe today. He is the doyen and inspiration of the democratic left in Germany, and in keeping with the tenets of his philosophy, makes frequent critical interventions, as a citizen rather than as an academic, in the German and European public spheres on matters of general cultural, moral, and political concern. To keep this book short, I've provided very little information about Habermas's life. This is not because it is uninteresting, though the lives of academics rarely make for ripping biographies, but because I believe the work is more important than the man. That said, I shall not go so far as Martin Heidegger, who, when writing about the philosopher Aristotle, noted only that he was born at such and such time, he worked and died. Habermas's work was informed and motivated by the momentous historical events he lived through, in particular by the end of the Second World War in 1945, the emergence of the Federal Republic of Germany from its economic and social ruins, the Cold War, the student protests of 1968, the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, and the demise of the Soviet Union. Habermas was born in Düsseldorf in 1929. He was brought up in a middle-class German family who uncritically adapted to the Nazi regime without actively supporting it. His own political views first took shape in 1945 when he was 16. Towards the end of the war, like nearly all healthy German adolescents of his age, he joined the Hitler Youth Movement. After the war, when he viewed the Holocaust film documentaries and followed the proceedings of the Nuremberg trials, his eyes opened to the horrifying reality of Auschwitz and the full extent of the collective moral catastrophe of the Nazi period. As a young man, he studied philosophy in Göttingen, Zurich, and Bonn. He was no radical. Between 1949 and 1953, he immersed himself in the work of Martin Heidegger. However, he soon became disillusioned with him, not so much because of Heidegger's membership of and public support for the Nazis, but because of his subsequent evasiveness, his refusal to express any sorrow for his actions, to acknowledge them and put them behind him. In 1949, the first government of the Federal Republic of Germany was established, led by the conservative Konrad Adenauer. The young Habermas's relation to Heidegger, which began with hopeful enthusiasm, but soon turned to feelings of disappointment and betrayal, was symptomatic of his relation to the whole Adenauer regime. In his view, it represented a collective and calculated refusal to acknowledge and break with the past. In 1954, Habermas obtained a doctorate with a dissertation on the German idealist philosopher Friedrich Schelling. He then turned to the work of Herbert Marcuse and the early Karl Marx, and 2 years later became the first research assistant of the philosopher Theodore W. Adorno at the Institute for Social Research at Frankfurt. Habermas was moved by the experience of his teachers at Frankfurt, Adorno and Max Horkheimer, both of German-Jewish origin, and both of whom had an understandably ambivalent sense of belonging to German tradition. For them, Habermas learned how to identify with his own German traditions from a critical distance, which enabled him, as he put it, to continue them in a self-critical spirit with the skepticism and the clear-sightedness of the man who has already once been fooled. In this period, Habermas's work became more radical and more sympathetic to Marx, too much so for the liking of Horkheimer, the Institute's director, who took exception to Habermas's openly Marxist views and engineered his departure from the Institute. In 1958, Habermas left Frankfurt for the University of Marburg, where in 1961 he received his habilitation. Thereafter, he became professor of philosophy at Heidelberg, and in 1964, returned to take up the post of professor of philosophy and sociology at the University of Frankfurt. During this time of political ferment, Habermas famously fell out with the student radicals, with whom he was broadly speaking sympathetic, when he provocatively termed their policy of out-and-out confrontation with all authority left fascism. From 1971 to 1983, he was the director of the Max Planck Institute in Starnberg. In 1983, Habermas returned to teach philosophy at the University of Frankfurt, where he established his reputation as a leading social theorist and as a respected voice of the democratic left in West Germany. In November 1989, the Berlin Wall fell, and in the aftermath, Habermas witnessed at first hand the unification of Germany. He was among those who were highly critical of the way the unification process was conducted. In the early 1990s, Habermas became increasingly interested in the work of the American political philosopher John Rawls, in his conception of liberalism, and in the tradition of American constitutional democracy. Habermas's critics on the left often paint a caricature of his career, according to which he began as a Marxist critic of capitalism and ended up as a defender of American liberal democracy. This caricature, though superficially plausible, is simplistic and based on an inability to grasp the complexity of his political and intellectual allegiances. Habermas was as much critic of Marxism as Marxist critic, and has always had grave misgivings about both capitalism and liberalism. Yet he counts West Germany's successful appropriation of the traditions of Western democracy as its greatest cultural achievement, even if he values these traditions more negatively as a way of breaking with the wrong continuities of his own political culture than positively. For just this reason, the German sociologist Ralph Dahrendorf went so far as to dub him, not without a certain irony, Adenauer's true grandson. In all this complexity, and in spite of the great changes in the intellectual and political climate of the last 50 years, there is an extraordinary continuity to Habermas's intellectual and political vision. I have sketched the psychological motivation and the biographical origins of Habermas's ambivalent relation to Germany and his enduring misgivings about nationalism. However, one should avoid the temptation to personalize these aspects of his work. It is easy to forget that the inherent complexities and tensions of recent German history and politics are alive and actual. This is made vivid to public visitors to the transparent dome of the Reichstag in Berlin, from where one can both look out toward the Brandenburg Gate and the new Holocaust Memorial, and also look right down into the parliamentary chamber below. No social and political theory captures these complexities and tensions as nicely and uses them to better advantage than Habermas's. They ground his cosmopolitanism, his support for the European Union, his distrust of nationalism and defense of constitutional patriotism, and his moral universalism. Habermas's philosophy is at once thoroughly German and not the least parochial. Retired from his post in Frankfurt since 1994, Habermas lives and writes in Starnberg and teaches part-time in the United States. He still regularly appears in print and is as active a political and cultural commentator as he ever was. Recently, he has written on subjects as diverse as bioethics, gene technology, Iraq, terrorism, cosmopolitanism, and American foreign policy after 9/11. Most of this book is given over to discussion of Habermas's mature theory, the work that appeared between 1980 and the present. I have devoted less space to his occasional political writings. There is no implied judgment here of the relative importance of Habermas's life as a public intellectual and his career as an academic. It is just that his theory is so much harder to grasp than are his political opinions and cultural observations, which are written for a lay audience and can stand alone. Habermas is, in a very German and nowadays somewhat unfashionable way, a purveyor of grand theory. He asks big questions about the nature of modern society, the problems facing it, and the place of language, morality, ethics, politics, and law within it. His answers are complex and wide-ranging, having been painstakingly pieced together from his knowledge of several different disciplines. Moreover, his major works are forbiddingly long and technical. He does not write for beginners, and reading his work for the first time can be a frustrating experience. While he concentrates on the big picture, he often leaves it to his collaborators and followers to fill in the details at a later date. Sometimes individual pieces of the argument are missing. At the same time, he is in constant dialogue with his critics and frequently reformulates his ideas in response to them, making small adjustments, the implications of which are not always obvious. For all these reasons, it is easy for readers who lack the big picture and do not know what is of central and what is of only marginal importance to lose their bearings. One aim of this book is to give the bigger picture by placing the different parts of his work in the context of the whole project. To that end, I shall begin by offering an outline of Habermas's entire body of mature work. It divides up into 5 research programs. 1. The pragmatic theory of meaning. 2. The theory of communicative rationality. 3. The program of social theory. 4. The program of discourse ethics. 5. The program of democratic and legal theory or political theory. Each program is relatively self-standing and makes a contribution to a separate area of knowledge. At the same time, however, each stands in a more or less systematic relation to all the others. Habermas's pragmatic theory of meaning, together with his theory of communicative rationality, provide the guiding ideas of his social, ethical, and political theory. In turn, these 3 research programs mutually support each other. I call them research programs because each of them is still ongoing. Each program answers a different set of questions by combining insights from different disciplines. In the following chapters, I go through these programs in roughly the chronological order in which Habermas conceived them. Chapter 1. Habermas and Frankfurt School Critical Theory. The Frankfurt School. Habermas is best known in the English-speaking world as the author of The Theory of Communicative Action, of various essays on discourse ethics, and of Between Facts and Norms, the works in which, roughly speaking, his social, moral, and political theory, respectively, are developed. Habermas is also known as the leading light of the second generation of Frankfurt School theorists, and his work is best understood as the fruit of an ongoing response to the critical theory of the first generation of Frankfurt School theorists. The Frankfurt School, as it has come to be known, was a group of philosophers, sociologists, social psychologists, and cultural critics who worked in the period before and after the Second World War for the privately financed Institute for Social Research based in Frankfurt. These thinkers, who published their work in the Institute's Journal for Social Research, worked, loosely speaking, within a common paradigm. That is, they shared the same assumptions, asked similar questions, and were all influenced by the dialectical philosophy of G.W.F. Hegel and Karl Marx. The modern German tradition of dialectical philosophy in which they worked, sometimes called Hegelian Marxism, was by no means the dominant one at the time. They were an intellectual minority, opposed to the reigning European tradition of neo-Kantianism and the Anglo-Austrian tradition of logical empiricism. This is how the retrospectively adopted talk of the Frankfurt School and of Frankfurt School theory should be understood. Max Horkheimer, the patrician director of the Institute, was chiefly responsible for developing the paradigm of critical theory during the 1930s. In Horkheimer's view, critical theory was to be a new interdisciplinary theoretical activity which supplemented and transformed the dialectical philosophy of Hegel and Marx, with insights from the relatively new discipline of psychoanalysis, from German sociology, anthropology, and less mainstream philosophers such as Friedrich Nietzsche and Arthur Schopenhauer. The resultant approach had four chief characteristics. It was interdisciplinary, reflective, dialectical, and critical. The Frankfurt School were among the first to approach questions of morality, religion, science, reason, and rationality from a variety of perspectives and disciplines simultaneously. They believed that bringing different disciplines together would yield insights that were unobtainable by working within narrow and increasingly specialized academic domains. Thus, they challenged the widespread assumption of the time that the empirical approach of the natural sciences was the only valid one. Unlike what Horkheimer called traditional theory, which included almost everything from mathematics and formal logic to natural science, critical theory was reflective, or inherently self-aware. A critical theory reflected on the social context that gave rise to it, on its own function within that society, and on the purposes and interests of its practitioners, and so forth, and such reflections were built into the theory. Together with its interdisciplinarity, the reflectiveness of critical theory was supposed to unmask what the Frankfurt School theorists considered to be the positivist illusion afflicting traditional theories, such as the natural sciences, namely that the theory is just the correct mirroring of an independent realm of facts. That dualist picture of knowledge encouraged the belief that facts were fixed, given, and unalterable, and independent of the theory. Critical theorists rejected that picture in favor of a more Hegelian, dialectical conception of knowledge, according to which the facts and our theories are part of an ongoing dynamic historical process in which the way we view the world, theoretically or otherwise, and the way the world is reciprocally determine each other. Finally, Horkheimer maintained that a critical theory should be critical. This requirement comprised several distinct claims. Generally, it meant that the task of theory was practical, not just theoretical. That is, it should aim not just to bring about correct understanding, but to create social and political conditions more conducive to human flourishing than the present ones. More specifically, it meant that the theory had two different kinds of normative aim, diagnostic and remedial. The goal of the theory was not just to determine what was wrong with contemporary society at present, but by identifying progressive aspects and tendencies within it, to help transform society for the better. When the political climate of Nazism made it impossible for its members, almost all of whom were of Jewish descent, to continue their work in Frankfurt, the Institute was temporarily relocated, first to Geneva and then to the United States, where they encountered at first hand a social phenomenon that was new to them. A consumer society in hock to a Fordist model of industrial capitalism and mass production. They were struck in particular by the way in which culture had been industrialized by big Hollywood film companies, broadcasting media, and publishing firms. These giant monopolistic corporations exerted subtle techniques of manipulation and control, which had the effect of making people accept and even affirm a social system that, behind their backs, thwarted and suppressed their fundamental interests. For example, the predictable happy endings of Hollywood B-movies provided ersatz satisfactions for mass audiences. Instead of being critical of social conditions that prevented them finding true happiness, they vicariously experienced the fictional happiness of their screen idols. Culture unwittingly played the role of an advertisement for the way things are. Horkheimer and his younger colleague, Theodore W. Adorno, referred to this phenomenon as the culture industry. It formed a vital part of a wider tendency of capitalist society to create and transform people's needs and desires to the extent that they actually desired the dross that was manufactured for them, and they ceased to want to lead fulfilling and worthwhile lives. Analysis of these phenomena furnished insights into the ways in which the consciousness of subjects could be manipulated by advertising and other means to create what the Frankfurt School theorists thought of as a false state of reconciliation. False reconciliation was brought about by the belief that the social world was rational, conducive to human freedom and happiness, and unalterable, when in fact it was deeply irrational, an obstacle to human freedom and happiness, and alterable. A century before, under rather different circumstances in Prussia, Hegel had argued that a true reconciliation had been reached, namely in those social and political conditions that rational subjects could accept and affirm, because, all things considered, they satisfied their deepest interests. The Frankfurt School, under the influence of Marx, and with their experience of the 20th century, turned Hegel's optimism upside down. By the time Horkheimer returned to Frankfurt in 1949, both he and Adorno had become more pessimistic about the chances of realizing the practical goal of critical theory, a radical transformation of society. This pessimism was grounded theoretically in the analysis set out in their famous co-authored Dialectic of Enlightenment. Adorno's and Horkheimer's analysis of Enlightenment sets the agenda for the subsequent development of critical theory. They began from the Hegelian assumption, shared by Marx, that human beings shape or determine the world around them through their mental and physical activity, or, as Marx would say, through their intellectual and manual labor. Then they added an historical thesis that by the 18th century, instrumental rationality, namely the calculation of the most efficient means for achieving a given end or desire, had become the dominant form of knowledge. The historical process of enlightenment privileged natural, scientific, and technologically exploitable forms of knowing above all others. Adorno and Horkheimer argued that the natural sciences, which make testable generalizations and predictions about external nature, are a covert form of means and ends reasoning. Anthropologically speaking, science is just an instrument that furthers man's fundamental need to master and control his environment. Technology and industry are the extension and application of this instrument. Adorno and Horkheimer claim that the industrialized and bureaucratized modern world is formed by a process of rationalization. The 20th century social world is the result of actions of human beings whose faculty of reason has atrophied to a mere calculus of the most efficient means to a given end. The increasing mathematization and objectification of nature has led to the demise of mythical and religious worldviews. At the same time, the concepts by which human beings come to know their world arise from specific historical and social circumstances. Adorno and Horkheimer argue that institutional life is increasingly formed by science and technology, that is, by instrumental rationality. Modern forms of sociality, institutionalized forms of instrumental rationality, give rise in their turn to instrumental concepts, representations, and ways of thinking about the world. They generate a scientific, calculating, and functional mindset. A vicious spiral ensues in which instrumental rationality becomes exclusive and total. There is a sinister aspect to the assumption that science and rationality serve man's underlying need to manipulate and control external nature. That domination and mastery are very close cousins of rationality. Not only science and technology, but rationality itself is implicated in domination. According to Horkheimer and Adorno, even primitive forms of rationality, like magic, are incipient forms of man's domination over nature and over other human beings. For magicians cast their spells in order to bring nature under control, and their having magic powers creates social hierarchies. Ironically, then, the very process of enlightenment, which was, according to 18th century enlightenment thinkers such as Rousseau, Voltaire, Diderot, and Kant, supposed to liberate man from nature and to lead to human freedom and flourishing, rebounds upon him. Gradually, as industrialization and capitalism take hold in the 19th century, human beings are subjected to ever more pervasive networks of administrative discipline and control, and to an increasingly powerful and untamable economic system. Instead of liberating man from nature, the process of enlightenment imprisons man, who is himself a part of nature. Instead of economic plenty, there is misery and poverty. Instead of moral progress, there is regression to barbarism, violence, and intolerance. This is the dialectic of enlightenment that informed Horkheimer's and Adorno's understanding of their social world and influenced their diagnosis of its faults. In the eyes of the young Habermas, this unwarranted pessimism blunted the critical aim of social theory. If their diagnosis was true, if enlightenment, which was supposed to bring human beings liberty and plenty, was, from its very inception, also destined to bring them unfreedom and misery, critical social theory was caught in a bind. For social theory is itself a form of enlightenment, on Adorno's and Horkheimer's very broad understanding of that term. It is a theory that should lead both to greater understanding of the social world and to its practical amelioration. In which case, as Adorno and Horkheimer acknowledge in the preface to Dialectic of Enlightenment, enlightenment is both necessary and impossible. Necessary because humanity would otherwise continue hurtling towards self-destruction and unfreedom, and impossible because enlightenment can only be attained through rational human activity. And yet rationality is itself the origin of the problem. This was the aporia that led Horkheimer and Adorno to become ever more circumspect about the concrete political aims of critical theory. Aporia is a Greek word meaning literally no passage, and figuratively, perplexity. Adorno's faith in the capacity of any theory to guide social, political, or moral emancipation soon waned to the point that he considered almost any collective political action to be premature, arbitrary, and futile. The difference between Habermas and his teachers is that while they thought the aporia was real, he thought it resulted from a flaw in their analysis. Habermas's initial response. Habermas's first major work, Structural Transformation of the Public Sphere, An Investigation of a Category of Bourgeois Society, is a constructively critical response to Horkheimer's and Adorno's conception of critical theory. Though something of a cause célèbre in West Germany in the early 1960s, it was not translated into English until 1993. It attempts to resolve the problems of first-generation Frankfurt School critical theory while remaining true to its original spirit and retaining some aspects of its diagnosis of social ills. Structural transformation remains true to the original paradigm in several ways. First, it is interdisciplinary, combining insights from history, sociology, literature, and philosophy. Second, it aims to locate the progressive, rational aspects of modern society and to differentiate them from the regressive, irrational ones. Third, like Horkheimer and Adorno before him, Habermas employs the method of immanent criticism. One can also call it internal as opposed to external criticism. The critical theorists think this approach derives from Hegel and Marx. In some respects, it is closer to the Socratic mode of argumentation, which assumes the position of the interlocutor for the sake of argument without actually endorsing it, in order to point out its incoherence and untruth. Whatever its origins, the critical theorists aim to criticize an object, a conception of society or a work of philosophy, on its own terms, and not on the basis of values or standards that transcend it, in order to bring its untruth to light. Structural transformation is an immanent criticism of the category of the public sphere, a phrase that translates the German word Öffentlichkeit, which can mean publicity, transparency, and openness. According to Habermas, the ideals of the historical Enlightenment, liberty, solidarity, and equality, are implicit in the concept of the public sphere and provide the standard of immanent criticism. For example, 18th and 19th century bourgeois society can be criticized for not living up to its own ideals. Equally, West German society can be criticized for having fallen short of the inclusive, equal, and transparent society foreshadowed by those ideals. Thus, structural transformation cleaves to the theoretical and practical aspirations of the original paradigm of critical theory, to understand the social world and to guide social change by illuminating potentials for social change. However, Habermas provides a significantly different historical diagnosis of the social, political, and cultural situation to Horkheimer and Adorno. Although he does not openly criticize them until nearly two decades later, long after their deaths, Habermas thought that their account of rationalization was too one-sided and pessimistic, and that their concept of the dialectic of enlightenment lacked both empirical and historical justification and conceptual coherence. His own work attempts to rescue the original idea of critical theory by combining a more nuanced and justifiable history of the Enlightenment with a more coherent model of social theory. The concept of the bourgeois public sphere. Structural transformation charts the emergence of a reasoning public out of the literary public of the salons, clubs, and coffeehouses of 18th century Europe, and then depicts its gradual decline and disintegration. Habermas's narrative is quite detailed and betrays an extraordinary range of reference. At the beginning of the 18th century, the establishment of civic rights guaranteeing the individual freedoms of association and of expression, and the emergence of a free press gave rise to physical spaces such as coffee houses and salons, and to literary journals, in which citizens could enter into free public discussion. There were fora in which people voluntarily came together and participated as equals in public debates. These arenas were autonomous in two senses. Participation in them was voluntary, and they were relatively independent of the economic and political systems. Members of the public sphere did not just transact economically through exchange and contract in the pursuit of individual profit and self-interest. The public sphere consisted in voluntary associations of private citizens united in a common aim: to make use of their own reason in unconstrained discussion between equals. Soon a shared culture developed that, among other things, helped the participants to discover and to express their needs and interests, and to form a conception of the common good. According to Habermas, a normative notion of public opinion crystallized around the conception of the common good that was established in these fragile but sheltered arenas of public discourse. As the authority and influence of the public spread, so gradually public opinion began to function as a check on the legitimacy of the powers of unrepresentative and closed government. By checking whether laws and policies were in the common good, the public could effectively test their legitimacy. Though the public sphere came to exercise a political and social function, however, it cannot be identified or associated with any particular political institution. It was an informal sphere of sociality, located somewhere between bourgeois civil society and the state of government. The public sphere as idea and ideology. Habermas's critical theory, as expounded in Structural Transformation, is a variant of immanent criticism known as the criticism of ideology, or ideology criticism. In order to understand what this is, we first have to examine the notion of ideology. Adorno defines ideology as socially necessary illusion, or socially necessary false consciousness, and the young Habermas accepts something like the same definition. Ideologies are, on this view, the false ideas or beliefs about itself that society somehow systematically manages to induce people to hold. But ideologies are not ordinary false beliefs, such as my false belief that there is tea in my cup when there is coffee. Rather, ideologies are false beliefs that are very widely assumed to be true, because virtually all members of society are somehow made to believe them. Moreover, ideologies are functional false beliefs, which, not least because they are so widespread, serve to shore up certain social institutions and the relations of domination they support. This is the sense in which ideologies are socially necessary. Ideology, in this sense, can fulfill social functions in various different ways.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.